Section 27 of The Evolution of Modern Medicine. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Larry Wilson. The Evolution of Modern Medicine by Sir William Osler. Chapter 6. Rise of Preventive Medicine, Tuberculosis. In a population of about 1 million, 1,700 persons died of tuberculosis in this state in the year 1911, a reduction in 30 years of nearly 50%. A generation has changed completely our outlook on one of the most terrible scourges of the race. It is simply appalling to think of the ravages of this disease in civilized communities. Before the discovery by Robert Cook of the bacillus, we were helpless and hopeless. In an oriental fatalism, we accepted with folded hands a state of affairs which use and want had made bearable. Today, look at the contrast. We are both helpful and hopeful. Knowing the cause of the disease, knowing how it is distributed, better able to recognize the early symptoms, better able to cure a very considerable portion of all early cases, we have gradually organized an enthusiastic campaign which is certain to lead to victory. The figures I have quoted indicate how progressively the mortality is falling. Only do not let us be disappointed if this comparatively rapid fall is not steadily maintained in the country at large. It is a long fight against a strong enemy, and at the lowest estimate, it will take several generations before tuberculosis is placed at last with leprosy and typhus among the vanquished diseases. Education, organization, cooperation, these are the weapons of our warfare. Into details I need not enter. The work done by the National Association under the strong guidance of its secretary, Mr. Farrand, the pioneer studies of Trudeau, and the optimism which he has brought into the campaign, the splendid demonstration by the New York Board of Health of what organization can do, have helped immensely in this worldwide conflict. Some years ago, in an address at Edinburgh, I spoke of the triple gospel which man has published, of his soul, of his goods, of his body. This third gospel, the gospel of his body, which brings man into relation with nature, has been a true evangelion, the glad tidings of the final conquest of nature by which man has redeemed thousands of his fellow men from sickness and from death. If in the memorable phrase of the Greek philosopher Prodicus, "That which benefits human life is God," we may see in this new gospel a link betwixt us and the crowning race of those who eye to eye shall look on knowledge, and in whose hand nature shall be an open book, an approach to the glorious day which Shelley sings so gloriously. Happiness and science dawn though late upon the earth. Peace cheers the mind. Health renovates the frame. Disease and pleasure cease to mingle here. Reason and passion cease to combat here. Whilst mind unfettered o'er the earth extends its all-subduing energies and wields the scepter of a vast dominion there. Damon of the World, Part 2. End of Section 27. End of The Evolution of Modern Medicine by Sir William Osler.